نحمده ونصلي ونسلم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد رسوله النبي الأمين المكين الحنين الكريم الرؤوف الرحيم. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين، آمين. صدق الله مولانا العظيم. Dear listener and viewers, by the grace and mercy of Almighty Allah, we have to discuss today again the concept of guidance in the light of Suratul Fatiha. The fifth verse of Suratul Fatiha contains the subject of concept of hidayah, concept of guidance. It is stated, اِهْدِنَ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, O our Lord, guide us to the right path. We have discussed various aspects regarding the concept of guidance in our last episode. What is the concept of guidance? What are the prerequisites of guidance? What are various requirements of a perfect guidance? What are the scopes of guidance? What are the levels of guidance? What are the kinds of guidance? All of these things we have already elaborated. Now, a very significant point which we want to discuss today in the connection of guidance is that how the guidance of Holy Quran is achieved with full guarantee. Because when this prayer has been educated to the people, to the Muslims, that O Muslims, O seekers of guidance, O worshippers, O faithful, you have to seek for Allah's guidance. You have to seek for divine guidance in this way, in this manner. The question arises that what is the method of getting guaranteed guidance which Quran wants us to get? Because Holy Quran says, when Satan was kicked out the paradise and from the place of nearness of Almighty Allah, when he refused to bend down before Hazrat Adam, in spite of the order and commandment of Almighty Allah, Almighty Allah said, فَخْرُجْ مِنْهَا فَإِنَّكَ رَجِيمٌ. Iblis, O Satan, get out of it. Today you have been deprived of my special place of nearness. At that time, it is stated in Holy Quran, in all books which were divinely revealed on various prophets, Satan said, فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. O Lord, by your respect, by your honor, I would make the whole of the mankind astray. I would take the whole of the mankind on right path. I would deprive them from the right path, and I would take them towards wrong path. I would make them astray. illa ibadaka minhumul mukhlaseen, except those people who are chosen by you, to whom you have chosen, to whom you have selected, and who those people who have got your special blessing of nearness, those who have been blessed with special divine guidance, who have been blessed with your special grace, who have been blessed with your special divine favor, and favor of your divine selection, and divinely being chosen. So those people would not go astray in spite of my efforts. They would be protected by you and your guidance. They would be preserved. So except those special people who would be the chosen people, al-mukhlaseen, other ones, all of the mankind except those, I would try them to get astray and I will take them on wrong path. And again at another place, it is stated in Holy Quran, Satan said, لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ صِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. O Lord, I will sit in your right path, صِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, your right path, the right path which you have fixed, and you will guide the people towards right path, and they, after your guidance, after your instruction, after your giving them light of the right path, they will follow it, they will go on right path, and they will be walking on right path, and they will be going on right path, and I will sit in right path, I will sit in the guided path, so that to make those people astray who are already walking on right path, who have been guided, I will take them towards wrong way. I will attack them and their faith. I will attack them and their belief. I will create confusions in their faith. I will create conflicts and misconceptions and misunderstandings in their faith, and they would be astrayed. So the concept is that although the Satan and the evil forces, devil and evil forces, and all of the evil forces, they are working to take the mankind astray. They are working to take the mankind going on wrong path. They are working so that the people may deviate from right path. They are working to create conflicts. They are working to create confusions. And they are working to create misconceptions in the minds of the people, so that they may be deprived of the blessing of divine guidance. And their special attacks are on those people who are already on right path, because those who are already astray, who are already on wrong path, who are already deviated from right path, and who are already away from the nearness and mercy of Allah, they are already friends of Satan. They are already the sharers and friends of devil and devil forces. So he has not to bother much for them, because they are already wrongdoers and going on wrong side. The Satan, devil and devil forces are already satisfied with those people who are wrongdoers, who are sinners, who are deviated. He bothers specially for those who are on right faith, who are practicing Islam, who are on right, doing good deeds. He wants them to take off from the right path. So the question is, when devil and devil forces are always attempting to attack on those who are going on right path, so it means that there are possibilities that guidance may be snatched by the people, from the people. There is the possibility of being snatched, guidance being snatched, and the people being deprived of guidance, and people becoming astray. In spite of going on right path, there is a possibility of wrong way. So the question is that, as we already discussed in our last episode, here in the light of this possibility of damage, in the light of this possibility of harm, in the light of this possibility of misfortune, now the man wants not only the guidance to right path, but wants the security in arriving at destination safely, wants the certainty to reach the destination safely. So this is known as guaranteed guidance, which provides the man with surety of reaching the destination. So the question is, what would be the method of getting this guaranteed guidance? Here the answer has been given by Holy Quran at the same place in Surah Al-Fatiha. The first verse, this fifth verse, which we have firstly recited, this gives the question. In the words following, these words give the answer. It is stated, اِهْدِنَ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. O Lord, guide us to the right path, which is stable, which is sound and profound. And next comes the answer. What would be the right path, which would provide the stability to the people, which would provide the safety to the people, and which would provide the security to the people, and which will make the people secure from satanic attacks, secure from satanic attempts, and secure from satanic attempts of misguiding the people. So we should know that guaranteed method in which there lies the security. So Holy Quran has answered the question, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. It is said, after the prayer, Almighty Allah, guide us to the right, safe and secure path. What is the safe, secure and guided path, right path? Answer comes, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. The path of those on whom you have bestowed your blessings, the path of the best, the path of the blessed people on whom you have showered your blessings. It means, show us the right path. Which path? Here the guidance has been personified. Here is the question of personification of guidance. Path of those who have been blessed with special divine guidance, who have been blessed with special divine favors, who have been blessed with special divine mercies. So path of those who are divinely blessed is the path which can give safety and security to reach the destination. Here first lies the concept of personification of the path of guidance. Then question arises that Quran has mentioned the personified guided path. In general manner, it is said, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, path of those who are blessed. So who will determine the blessed people? The next question arises, how it would be decided? Who is the blessed man? Who are the blessed people on whom the showers of divine blessings and favors and mercies have been done? Again, this is a question to be answered. So its answer has also been provided by Holy Quran in the word, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. Those who obey Allah and obey the Prophet and Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be in the company of those who are blessed. Here three points are to be considered. First of all, it is said, those who obey Allah and His Prophet, obey Allah and obey Prophet, obey Messenger, number one. Number two, فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. So those people would be in the divine and good company of those who are blessed. So they would be provided with the company. مَعَ الَّذِينَ مَعِيَّةَ. Here is the concept of company. They would be provided with a very good spiritual and divine company of those who are blessed. And whom are the blessed? The four categories. An-Nabiyyin, the prophets and messengers. As-Siddiqeen, the righteous people. Was-Shuhada, those who have given their lives in the way of Allah. Those who are the sacrificers of their lives for Allah. Those who have given their lives in the way of Allah, for the cause of Allah. And was-Salihin, those who are pious, are the blessed people. So these are the four categories of the blessed people. Now first of all, we will deal with the question of personification in the light of this verse. مَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ. Those who obey Allah and the Messenger. So this is the first requirement for the achievement of guaranteed guidance. So there is no guaranteed guidance without at the same time obedience to Allah and obedience to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is necessary to understand the thing that abstract and exclusive obedience to Allah without obedience to Holy Prophet and without submission to Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is no obedience to Allah. So obedience to Allah has again been personified by the obedience to Prophet, because the Prophet and Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been made the direct recipient of divine authority. He has been made the manifestative and representative of divine authority, and he has been made the reflective, he has been given the reflective capacity of divine authority. So the first requirement of the guaranteed divine guidance is that the people should at the same time obey Allah and His Prophet. If the people obey Almighty Allah and say that we obey Allah and we obey the commands of Holy Quran, and the commands of Holy Quran are sufficient for us and nothing else, we require nothing else. There is no need of Sunnah. There is no need of Prophet's tradition. There is no need of Prophet's conduct. We will stick only to Holy Quran and we will not take guidance on the Sunnah of Holy Prophet, from the traditions and conduct of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Or those who consider only the Holy Quran as authority and do not consider the Sunnah of Holy Prophet Muhammad as authority, those who consider only the Quran as a source of guidance and do not consider the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his Sunnah as the source of guidance, they would be astray. They cannot possess, they cannot get the guaranteed guidance. Guaranteed guidance is only possible if مَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ, this condition is fulfilled. At the same time, two obedience are completed, two submissions are completed, submission to Allah. And what is submission to Allah? This is an abstract idea. Almighty Allah said, أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ, establish the prayer. This is the commandment of Allah to establish the prayer. Read Holy Quran right from Suratul Fatiha till the end of the Quran, Suratul Nas. The method how to offer the prayer has not been given in Holy Quran. The procedure of various timings of the salah and prayer and the elements of the prayer and all details of the prayer have not been given in Holy Quran. If a man thinks only the obedience to Allah and submission to commandment Allah and negates the necessity and indispensability of the submission to Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it is absolutely impossible for him to offer the prayer. Companions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's why they asked Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we are ordered and commanded to establish the prayer, but Quran has not given the method of offering the prayer. How would we offer the prayer? Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, sallu kama raaitumuni usalli. You just see me and offer your prayer as I offer. So the offering, the method of offering of the prayer, the method of Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam became the standard, became the ideal to be followed. So the first requirement which is to be fulfilled for the purpose of guaranteed guidance is at the same time to follow Allah and to follow His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not to differentiate between the necessity, of the Holy Prophet, Sunnah of Holy Prophet, and the commandment of Quran. Second thing which is mentioned in this verse is فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. This is the concept of personification. Otherwise, Almighty Allah has not revealed His book to all of the people. It was not impossible for Him. If He had wanted, He would have sent one manuscript or one book to each and every person of the world. He would have sent it. It was not impossible for Him, for His divine power. It was possible for Him within His power to send His commandment, to send His revelation, to send His instruction directly to the people. But He never adopted this way. He never sent His revelation, His communication, His instruction, His guidance directly to the people. He did not adopt this way. He raised a man from the people, from the community, made him His prophet, made him His messenger. He chose a man out of the people. وَالَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا. The people were ignorant. He raised one person out of them, gave him His prophethood and messengership, made him the prophet and messenger. He revealed His commandment unto him. He conveyed His instruction through revelation on his heart, and then asked, now, O my prophet, my passenger, communicate my instruction to your followers. Communicate my revelations to the people so that they may know my divine will through yourself. They may know my divine instruction through yourself. So the prophethood and messengership was made the indispensable intermediary factor between Almighty Allah and His creation. That's why the abstract divine guidance of Allah has been personified and has been characterized in the form of conduct and behavior of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second thing is ma'allazina anama Allahu alaihim. There would be company, and company of whom? Firstly of prophets, secondly was-siddiqeen, the people who are righteous, thirdly ash-shuhada, the sacrificers, and fourthly as-salihin, these people are awliya and sulaha, the pious people, the blessed people, the spiritual people, those who followed the footsteps of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and followed the pleasure of Almighty God. So the guidance was personified in the form of these four categories, and it was said that you should follow the footsteps of those people. So the next point which is very clear in this verse is that Almighty Allah has not confined only up to the abstract guidance of Quran and the personified guidance of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He has shown further way how to testify that this way is really the way of Prophet, and this way is really the guidance of Quran. That's why Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it continued the same thing next, said, عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين. You have to follow my footsteps, my sunnah, and the sunnah of my caliphs, the guided caliphs. So the guided caliphs were also were made the representative of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet was made the representative of Allah, and the guided caliphs and the people who were blessed in the ummah of Holy Prophet, the salihin, the awliya, and the atqiya, the pious people, the righteous people, and the true people, they were made the representatives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A specific continuing line till the day of judgment was made and said, try to understand what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has communicated to you through the righteous and pious people, and try to understand what the divine guidance is through the will of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the practical way which has been adopted by the blessed people of his ummah. So this is the basic concept given by Holy Quran, and the concept of guaranteed guidance, the method of guaranteed guidance which can be achieved. Now these words, ihdinas sirat al-mustaqim, again the word sirat, the way, and the stable way, again indicates a thing that the guidance of Holy Quran, given by Holy Quran, is not only the thought, it is an intention. Because the man, if one only wants to know what is the destination and he is not interested in knowing the path, he is talking of thought, not of practice. So as-sirat, the way, and al-mustaqim, the stability, the profoundness and security of reaching the destination. This is the character of Quranic guidance. So the Quran, there is a difference between Quranic guidance and guidance of other forms. So the Islam, religion of Islam, is not only thought, that is in fact the intention. Islam is not only knowledge, that is in fact the act and practice. Islam is not only name of preaching, the name of practicing. And Islam is not only the name of analysis and explanation, it is the name of creation. Islam is not only the name of knowing any reality, it is the name of achieving the reality. That's why Islam is not only theoretical and philosophical religion, it is a practical religion. It is pragmatic religion and wants and demands his followers to adopt the practical methods given by the Prophet and given by Quran sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's why a Muslim, true Muslim, is the man who is a practical Muslim, and a true faithful is a man who is a practical faithful and who regulates his life practically in accordance with the light of Sunnah and in accordance with the light of Holy Quran. This is the method, and who avoids the wrong association of wrongdoers, ghayril maghdubi alayhim waladdallin. Tell us the path of the blessed people, and we will abstain from those who are in wrath and those who are astray. At the same time, association of good people is required and disassociation of wrong people is required, because Islam has given negation of wrong and affirmation of right in the form La ilaha illallah. We negate the wrong, we negate the evil, illallah, and we affirm the right and we affirm the good. Same philosophy has been adopted in Surah Al-Fatiha. We pray Almighty Allah may bless us with His divine guidance so that we may negate and eliminate every kind of evil from our life, and we may affirm every kind of good and righteousness and every kind of divine blessing in our life. Almighty Allah may bless us with divine blessing. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ. وَسَلِّمُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا وَمَوْلَانَا مُحَمَّدٍ رسوله النبي الأمين المكين الحنين الكريم الرؤوف الرحيم. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. صدق الله مولانا العظيم. Dear listeners and viewers, today by the grace of Almighty Allah, we are going to concentrate on the subject of Surah Al-Fatiha and system of human thought and deed. This This is a very significant subject. In Surah Al-Fatiha has given us a very everlasting and practical light on this subject. Islam is a practical deen. That's why it has provided the mankind with full system of thoughts and deeds, so that the human conduct may properly be regularized in the light of the valid thoughts and valid deeds provided by the teachings of Holy Quran and Islam. So Surah Al-Fatiha has provided a system consisting of 8 principles, and these principles deal with a full-fledged system of human thought and deed, which constitutes a comprehensive human conduct. All of these 8 principles, which constitute a system of thought and deed, are: number 1, accuracy and validity of belief; number 2, soundness of conduct; number 3, sense of answerability; number 4, fixation of purpose and destination; number 5, stability in the struggle; number 6, firm faith in success in struggle of life; number 7, cooperation with the right people; and number 8, non-cooperation with the wrong people. These are 7-8 principles which provide us with a regular system of human thought and deeds, and this system ultimately constitutes a full-fledged human behavior, a full-fledged human conduct, which is required by Holy Quran to be adopted by the mankind. So first of all, dealing with the principle of accuracy and validity of belief, the first 3 verses of Surah Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahmanir Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, these are the 3 verses which give us a light regarding the basic 3 tenets of Islamic faith. Although there are 6 basic tenets on which Islamic faith is established, but 3 of them possess the pivotal role. The first of those basic 3 tenets are the faith of monotheism, the second is faith in prophethood, and third is faith in life hereafter, or faith in resurrection, or faith in the day of judgment. The basic thing is that all of human acts which we normally perform are out of specific intentions and motives. We are talking of intentional acts, not of unintentional acts. So those acts which matter in human life and through which human conduct comes into existence, which constitute a regular behavior of man, so those acts are essentially intentional acts, not unintentional. So every intentional act is based on a specific idea, and every intentional act is performed on the basis of specific purpose. The idea behind the performance of the act, the purpose behind the performance and commission of a specific act, that is known as motive, niyya, motive for which a man commits a certain act, motive or the purpose for the achievement of which a man performs a specific deed. So there's that motive or that purpose is essentially an idea, a concept. In fact, this concept works as aqidah, works as faith, works as belief. So the motive, in fact, comes into existence out of a specific faith, out of a specific belief. The idea or the concept comes into existence, and that idea or concept gives rise to a specific motive, and that motive gives rise to a specific intentional act. So out of this process, the act comes into existence. So the question of validity of an act or invalidity of an act is based on two things. Number one, the physical commission of the act, the manner in which, the physical manner in which the act was committed, or the method or means in which the performance of act took place. So this is the physical aspect of the act. And second thing which determines the validity or invalidity of the act, that is the motive, idea behind the act. So if the basic idea behind the act or the motive behind the act is right, act would become a good act. If the motive behind the act is wrong or malicious, the act would become impure act and wrong act. So the motive, whether valid or invalid, whether good or bad, whether right or wrong, this motive comes into existence out of the basic aqidah, basic faith, basic belief. So that's why the accuracy and validity of belief is required in order to perform, for the purpose of the performance of good act. That's why Holy Quran has based the Surah Al-Fatiha, the first three declarations are based on the validity of faith. First of all, this verse says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all the praise be to Allah, who is the Lord, cherisher and sustainer of all the worlds. So this verse indicates the faith in monotheism, the faith in oneness of Almighty Allah, which means the basic element or the first element which validates the belief of the man, which makes the faith and belief of the man a correct basis, a valid basis, a sound basis and right basis. That is aqidah to tawheed, monotheism and aqidah of oneness, faith of oneness of Almighty Allah. So Surah Al-Fatiha says that the purpose for which the act is being performed should be known, that it is out of the commission in accordance of the commandment of Almighty Allah. If the belief and faith of man is in Almighty Allah, in oneness of Allah, he knows that my Lord has commanded me to do so and so, and I have to perform the act for the purpose of attainment of the pleasure of my Lord. So this connection of the man with this faith of oneness automatically renders the act as a good act. And the second thing is the faith in prophethood, which means that, as mentioned in second verse of Surah Al-Fatiha, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah is the magnificent and merciful, and through His mercy, Almighty, as we have already discussed in earlier episodes, that best of the mercies of Almighty Allah is the form of prophethood, is the form of messengership, that He has provided the mankind with the light of conduct, with the charter of guidance, through His divine revelation, communicated to His holy prophets and messengers. And then prophets convey the light of divine guidance to the mankind. So prophethood is the best form of divine mercy of Almighty Allah. So through Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the second point of validity of act, validity of belief, is that the man should know that if I would perform an act in accordance with the guidance and in accordance with the code of conduct given by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or given by the messenger in the light of divine revelation communicated to the Prophet, then my conduct would be known to be a good conduct, a valid conduct, as acceptable conduct and pious conduct. And if I will perform an act in consistency with the code of conduct given by Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or given by the code of conduct provided through divine revelation, so my act or my conduct would be regarded as impious act, wrong act, and deviative act. So to make human conduct and human act a good conduct and a good act, it is necessary that it should be positively in consonance with the code of conduct given by Prophet. So this aspect of human belief again makes the human thought and human deed a good thought and good deed. And if there is no check and no balance, neither on human thought nor on human conduct and human deed, there is no balance of divine code of conduct, there is no balance of divine charter of guidance, then he is free to do whatsoever he wants, at least in his personal affairs of his life. Personal affairs of his life, in his moral affairs, in his ethical affairs, in his domestic affairs, in his private affairs, in his dealing towards other people. So he will be free, and this absolute, unchecked, and unlimited freedom of man creates a lot of problems. So his freedom should be channelized in the light of a specific code of conduct given by the divine revelation through the pattern of behavior of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the second aspect which makes the human belief and human thought and human deed a good thought, a good deed, and balanced thought and balanced deed. The third aspect of the system of human thought and deed pertaining to the accuracy of belief, that is the faith in the day of resurrection. For example, if a man commits an act and he knows that he is not going to be resurrected, and he is not going to be answerable before any else, anybody, any power, any authority, this is the all story, this world is the whole story. He thinks that if I would murder anybody, I would deviate from the right path, I would commit a sin, I would be cruel and unjust to any person, unjust to anybody, and he knows that the worldly court or the worldly law, the state law is everything. So if he makes and manages and maneuvers to get rid of the grip of the worldly law, to get rid of the grip of the state law, he would be successful. So if he manages these things and there is no idea behind the act, if there is no idea in his mind to be answerable in life hereafter, so there would be no check on his commission of crime. There will be no check on his commission of cruel act of cruelty. And otherwise, if he knows that this state law is not all the thing, this state law is not the whole story, I can be punished through the state law on commission of a crime. But even if I get rid of the eyes of the state law, and I am not punished through the court, and I try and I manage to get rid of the grip of the state law, even then there is a divine court, and that court is the court of Almighty Allah. And after my death, I have to reappear before him, before the court. I would be appearing before Allah, and I have to become answerable on each and every act of mine before Almighty Allah. So it is possible to manage to get rid of the grip of the state law, but this is not possible to manage to get rid of the grip of the divine law. So it would be not possible to get rid of the grip of divine law. I would be awarded punishment on each and every sin. I would be asked about each and every act, and I would be rewarded or awarded on each and every aspect of my conduct. So if this idea is behind the mind, and he knows and believes in firmly in this thing, so this would again make his act, make his conduct, make his behavior accurate, valid and good. And he will try to become pious, and he will try himself to get rid of every kind of wrong things. So this thing would create sincerity of purpose. Sincerity of purpose, loyalty to purpose, piety in his act, accuracy in his conduct, firmness and soundness in his conduct. So this thing would be helpful for the man to achieve the status of piety. The second thing is the accuracy of conduct or soundness of conduct. Again, this concept has been given by Surah Al-Fatiha through fourth verse. Holy Quran says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Here two commandments have been given. The first commandment of worship to Allah, and secondly commandment of seeking help from Almighty Allah. Ibadah and isti'ana. Ibadah means one should exclusively worship Almighty Allah. And here isti'ana means one should exclusively be the seeker of help from Almighty Allah. So there are two cycles of human acts. One cycle is known as cycle of worship, and second cycle is known as cycle of seeking of health. So this aspect provides the light of the correctness and accuracy of human conduct in a system of life. For example, if he knows that if I would act in accordance with the divine will and divine pleasure of Allah, then my each and every act, whether it is temporal, whether it is physical, whether it is fiscal in its nature, whether it is political, whether it is economic, it is cultural, whether it pertains to earning money, whether it pertains to dealing with other people, any kind of act, temporal or spiritual, if it is committed in accordance with the divine will of Allah, in accordance with for the purpose of the divine pleasure of Almighty Allah, the same act would become worship, an act of worship. This would known to be worship of Almighty Allah. And this act of worship will make the whole life as a unit of worship to Almighty God. So this concept would provide a correctness and soundness of conduct. And at the same time, when he says things that if he seeks help for commission of every act, seeks help from Almighty Allah, he will never seek help for committing a wrong act. The man can never seek help of Allah for the purpose of performing an act, that act which is already in deviation of divine will of Almighty Allah. When he has to seek help from Allah, so definitely he would seek help for the purpose of commission of those acts, which acts can become the reason of attainment of pleasure of Allah. So this concept of worship and concept of health, again together, they will provide the man as a good system of thought and good system of deed. And it will purify, and it will purify the conduct of man in this case. The third aspect, which is given through Surah Al-Fatiha, in connection of the system of thought and deed, that is the sense of answerability before Allah, or the thoughtfulness of answerability before God. So, again, in Holy Quran, it is very much clear that a man has to become answerable before Almighty Allah. This idea is developed and derived from Maliki Yawmiddin, this third verse. It is stated that Allah is the master and is the owner of the day of judgment. So the system of thought and deed, based on the concept of thoughtfulness of answerability, based on the concept of sense of being answerable to Almighty Allah, and sense of being awarded and rewarded by Almighty Allah. This is one element of Islamic system of thought and deed, provided by Surah Al-Fatiha. This means that Quran says the man that he should be very much aware of the fact that he has to be answerable to Almighty Allah on his all acts, on his all deeds, and on his all aspects of human conduct and behavior. So to be answerable, the sense of being answerable means that the man is not absolute in his authority. He is not absolute in his authority. It means that his every act is to be checked. That's why he should be balanced. He has to be answerable on his all acts and deeds. That's why he should be very careful. He is going to be awarded and rewarded. That's why he should be very pious, very sensible. So the sense of answerability would create an effect of check and balance of human conduct. This sense would create a check and balance on human behavior. And if he thinks that he is absolutely free and independent and unbalanced, his acts are unchallengeable, his acts are unquestionable, and he is unanswerable, and there is no court and no authority in this universe to whom he is going to be responsible and answerable for his conduct. So this means that he will never evaluate his performance. He will never assess his performance whether he is doing good or bad. There would be no element of differentiation between his goodness and his evil, good and evil. So the sense and thoughtfulness of answerability would create an effect of self-evaluation, of self-assessment and self-criticism. He will concentrate in his inner self. For example, the whole day he has passed before he goes to bed. This is an element of thought given by Surah Al-Fatiha in the light of the concept of sense of answerability, that before the day when he has to become answerable to Almighty Allah, why should not he himself become answerable to himself? Before the death, the day of death will come, and a story of worldly world would come to its end. Why should not he consider the sleep of every night as his death, similar to death, the sleep of every night? So before he goes to bed and he sleeps, he should think on his acts and deeds, he should think on his conduct and behavior, which starts right from the beginning of the day till the end of the day, that what he has been committing, what he has been performing, what he has been doing throughout the day. So when he will concentrate on his performance, on his conduct, on his deed, on his acts, whether good or bad, throughout the day, before he goes to sleep, since considering his sleep similar to death, he will say, think that my this day is damageful for me, is harmful for me. I have lost, I have not gained through this day. So he will repent on it. He will ask for forgive. And he will think that if this day has gone in loss, I should make my next day for gain, for betterment, for improvement, for advancement. So that's why this concept of re-evaluation, this concept of self-evaluation, self-assessment and self-criticism would provide him the way towards his completion, the way towards his perfection. And every day which will come in his life would be better as compared to the last day, the day which has gone. So the concept of Maliki Yawmiddin gives the idea of answerability, and this answerability possesses an effect of check and balance on human conduct, and human conduct is become a balanced conduct, become perfect conduct, become complete conduct, and only through this way of concept of answerability the man can go towards perfection, can go towards the completion of his moral perfection. So these are the three aspects which we have discussed today. Inshallah, the other five aspects of Islamic system of thought and deed we will be discussing inshallah in our next episode. Wama alayna illa al-balagh. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin. Sorry.